This is George Tomolachenko. He's the founder and
co-founder,
and co-director of the Health Technology and Engineering at USC. So it integrates, it's sort of near and dear to my heart because it's sort of similar to the Stanford By Design program where they have medical students as well as engineering students working together on using technology to create new medical new solutions to medical problems. And so he's going to be talking today about students. And so it's a pleasure to have you. Thank you so much.
Great to be here. Thank you. Thank you very much. Right. I guess I'll sit down. but I don't know if I stand up or sit down. But
it's your desk.
It's my desk.
Yeah,
it's
right.
It's a desk. I feel like I have to sit here like this and talk to the camera like this and then and stay away from Twitter. Again, George Tomolachenko, this program was created by Drs. Terry Sanger and I at the behest of the engineering dean and the medical school dean because they saw tremendous potential in linking more closely engineering and medicine. Dr. Sanger came from Stanford where he was part of the initial kind of crew that helped with the birth of the biodesign program. And he was a frequent visitor, or I knew him. I've known Terry since Toronto. I mean, since Boston, and he stayed for a postdoc here in Toronto, and we got to start talking, and he told me about this wonderful program at Stanford, and I thought, that's something I'd like to do, be part of. And so that was sort of simmering in the background of my mind, but that was years before I actually came here to USC in 2010, and we created it from the ground up. The key difference here is the emphasis on students, and that's why I wanted to sort of title my talk about the students as the secret sauce, essentially, for innovation in a very busy place, in an intersection between a busy hospital and an academic center that are separated even. So you have students who can sort of go back and forth, and who can, in some instances, be the main drivers and sort of keep the momentum on projects going when people are busy doing their own stuff. So, and now you're looking at the title that doesn't quite match the title for today. But the key difference is that we're shifting it back. The original biodesign program at Stanford had people who had completed their MDs, who had completed their masters or PhDs in engineering, a small group, and this is the time that Terry was involved with the program, and really sort of they had a concentrated year to do that translational project, which is a good thing because in a way having that deadline really is an important factor, and that's essentially part of what design thinking actually teaches as well. And I'll get a little bit more into that as well. So in 2010, I came on board. We drafted a curriculum. If any of you want to write up a curriculum and get it through USC, I could probably help you a little bit with that. Yesterday I was talking with Dr. Ogilai from ENT, and he's in working with someone doing something like that. So. It is doable, fortunately, I was able to get it done in 1 year. It was really kind of interesting because that year, no one knew about the program, so I had to pick engineers and pick medical students who might be interested and kind of convince them that it was worth considering. I think I did a pretty good job. If any of you read the Keck news about the student, Hugh Gordon, who just graduated, he came to USC for medical school from Google, and it took him 7 years, but he graduated, but he also has a company going on data interoperability.
That was just today, the story about him.
Yeah, but maybe it was regurgitated today. But it was nice because it came in sync with his graduation, too. Here's a slide about one of the pieces that are themes that are important to me as a teacher for this program is to impart in the students and to build up and to exercise a capacity for empathy. And this is not purely, you know, empathy, you know, just for the patient, but empathy for the environment in into which you want to introduce some sort of innovation. How do you get a sense of not just, you know, how a device might improve a patient's outcomes, but what about the person who is using the device? How is it for him or her? Have you made a case, and do you understand the point of view of other stakeholders, including the hospital purchasing committee? All these important stakeholders that you have to appreciate and get into the mindset of to inform your decision. Do I really want to spend a couple years or more working to flesh out this idea to do this or not? So design thinking is, again, a little bit from Stanford. They, you know, through the design firm IDEO and the Stanford D School, Design School, it provides a toolkit, I would say, for really getting into the shoes of a busy clinician, a nurse manager, and understanding, you know, what are the motivations and their mindset, so that you can oftentimes help them see beneath an apparent problem. So, and this is one of the things we do a fair bit of is, and Greg will probably speak to this better than I can, in terms of the importance of really getting at a need in a way that sometimes has to steer around an apparent solution. So, you know, and one way this is boiled down, at Berkeley they use the phrase, what, not how, right? So oftentimes, you know, people will come in, doctors will say, this is how I want you to solve this problem, just do this and we will get there. Whereas the students should be practicing a deeper level, an empathic level of needs finding, where they say, what's the underlying need here? How can we rephrase this so that we can really sort of identify the problem or the need, or in a way that opens up more possibilities for solutions than the one presenting or presented by a busy clinician, because oftentimes they're really providing a solution instead of kind of a need in particular. So how do we do this? One of the things, and I mean, this slide just talks about a little bit of what I've said already. You know, how do you communicate ideas and problems in a way that opens up possibilities for engineers? Engineers want to be creative, want to be pathfinders themselves too, as opposed to being seen as a contractor, say. How can you create a dialogue where on both sides people are contributing to a new solution? And I think being able to sort of open up that dialogue requires a form of empathy. And you know, so where are these engineers is the question too. So they, you know, doctors need access to engineers, and again, how do you collaborate effectively? One of the reasons why we were excited about shifting this idea or mindset or methodology to students was that we can sort of teach them while they're learning to be doctors and engineers this way of parallel process thinking about how do you create a dialogue that allows for sort of more open contributions from both sides. So on the engineering side, you know, they need to understand how clinicians sort of live moment to moment, day to day, so they appreciate on their side, you know, the kinds of stressors. So when you don't get an answer right away from a doctor, don't take that personally. there's that kind of very basic level of understanding of different time scales and urgencies and priorities that the students on the engineering side should be mindful of. And they also, many of them don't have experiences. They're young people, so most of them probably haven't set foot in a hospital, or a good proportion of it. It's hard to imagine being a service provider in a hospital, but that's true. I mean, they're young, they're that's a great thing, but at the same time, it's hard to sort of step into the shoes of someone who is ill and really sort of, or just sort of the context of the hospital is not completely familiar. So we get engineers into the hospital. So if you're in the program, you get an ID, you get, you know, these days they're wearing white coats too, introducing themselves as health technology students, not as medical students. But they take a full course, a full year of introduction to clinical medicine with the medical students, first year medical students. By the end of the year, the medical students have had some coursework and they're doing some courses in, you know, say mental status and part of their neuroscience systems block. And unless the engineer is also happens to be taking that course, you know, is a little bit sort of out of phase at that point. But they do learn a basic physical exam, for instance. So, and this is a key component that Dr. Sanger emphasized right from the start, would be important. And again, on the engineering side too, how a dialogue, and the way I, the metaphor I use is that we get the kids to play nice together in the sandbox. When they're very young. So they hopefully will continue those habits after they graduate and be able to initiate a dialogue with clinicians with an idea and be receptive to other other ideas in a way that is facilitative of true innovation. Because I'm sure you've heard that innovation, unless it reaches a point of care or the market, is just an idea. You really have to take it to that point. And what we're making sure the students have is a basic vocabulary and some experience in the different sort of important considerations in that innovation process. I liken it more to a game of snakes and ladders where you can move up and get knocked down unpredictably and have to be sort of on your toes to admit that you've been knocked down and then move on and then just sort of taking different paths than you predicted. And you know, this is one of the key lessons after running the program for 5 years is that it's predictably unpredictable, non-linear, and these activities have to be, you know, to get engineering and medicine interwoven is pretty messy affair, mainly because there are different schedules. There are all sorts of different things on an academic side that I shouldn't really emphasize this, but what was, the reason why I include this as a lesson learned is that at first we thought we're going to have two engineers and two medical students and they're going to sort of work together in a quartet and, you know, make beautiful innovative music together, right? So. And they were supposed to go out and come back with a long list of needs, 100, 200 potential needs, filter them by market readiness, you know, all sorts of considerations that we had. But I quickly learned, for instance, that just like any sort of, you know, musical or group dynamic, you're going to have tensions, you're going to have people thinking they have the idea for the best innovative project, and you know, one of my functions, and I think Terry, in part, picked me to help him because my training is in clinical psychology, and I found myself becoming sort of in some cases the sort of a team shrink, and I was at first I was thinking, you know, well, this is interesting. I mean, it's group dynamics is important, and then when I compared notes with people at Stanford, they said, you know, that's probably one of the most important functions. We have this guy who does
Julian.
Julian, yes. Julian has since moved on,
yes.
And they've owned this as an important function to the point that the person that they hired in his place is a marriage counselor, apparently. I was just talking to someone the day before yesterday from the program. They're doing a survey of innovation programs. Actually, when they have their results, you should get them here too. I'll send you the contact info. And I've already talked about this. I mean, we really have sort of lifted and adapted the biodesign process for this program. Now, I'm going to step back from the slides because they can kind of be, I don't want them to lock. Oh, I see this, but you don't. Now, there's a Bible. it's showing me one slide ahead, and I'm like, oh, good. The stepping back, just to
we had empathically predicted what you were going to say.
Oh, good. I think I saw that in the reaction. Like, what is he talking about? I think George is hallucinating again. But when I slow down like this, I'm definitely hallucinating.
Yeah.
The point. I just wanted to get back from the slides because how does this work here is what I want to emphasize for you guys here. So we haven't done it with cardiovascular department yet, but sometimes we'll do a department kind of initial sort of meet and greet with the students, and people will, you know, suggest ideas or needs, and then the students will come back in pairs in the first semester and do a little bit more thorough sort of interview, and ideally they would follow up with some shadowing, so that you get a lot, and then they should come back with a long list of needs that, to us, Terry and I, and we can sort of go over those and go over those with you. Or it's really the students have to lead this and take ownership of it, because if they take ownership of it, you know, co-ownership with a mentor, and you would serve as a mentor for these students, then they're more likely to run with it, and when they really run with it, and they take it. There's a lot of places that we can take it internally that gives them some reward for their efforts as well. So what we could do at some point is discuss, you know, how this might work. I think going forward, with the number of students, I anticipate more master's students from the engineering side, which is kind of a watered down version on the engineering side, but I need to fill more sort of engineering positions for on the teams. We will open it up so that the students can go across different departments, and match that way. And so we've done work with radiology, orthopedics. At CHLA, we were in the NICU and the emergency room. This year, we worked at Keck. And they were more process-oriented issues around, you know, perioperative care and things like that, only one surgeon working with students. Yeah. So, in this point is that we can't complete all these projects. Sometimes, you know, they get to a point where the students realize that there's obstacles that would have to go through a very thorough and expensive regulatory pathway, and they sort of either they can hand it off to USC Tech Transfer, and some have done that. Others have just dropped the project. There's one project that actually won some awards in student innovation, but it was for, you know, it was very dicey on a legal front, and they realized that, and it was for a mesh, surgical mesh, and we kind of, this is where I think in hindsight we could have steered them away from that earlier, but they did well with the project as far as they took it. And sometimes we hand the projects kind of get sort of passed along to other students. There was one project that was a vein locator that seemed to have, you know, be passed on every couple of years to different students. And finally, I'm not sure that it's actually didn't start a company, but they definitely had IP out through CHLA. And one of the things that I'm looking toward, you know, doing more of is inviting undergraduates, actually. And so far at USC, the senior design course in biomedical engineering is pretty much, it's not open to different ideas. I have a grant proposal going in this cycle, small grant, that will create a summer immersion program for what, you know, rising seniors, you know, kids moving from junior to senior year in biomedical engineering, that will bring them into clinical sites and get them sort of juiced about, you know, needs, and I'll do a mini version of the bio design for them, and then they'll have ideas that they can take back to their senior capstone courses.
Is that internal or is that a T-series grant?
That's an ARC-25.
Oh, it is.
So
okay.
It's NIH. But I've been doing a version of this as well in the summer. There's a program called HTE Edge. I had had funding from NSF. It was leftover money, kind of fallen off the table, and I caught it and put it into this program. It was great because three of those projects went on to get I-Corps funding, actually. Some of them, well, you know, one was led by a prof. Like, it's open to anyone in the USC community. So I have everyone from undergrads that just won a hackathon in cancer to, you know, profs that have an operations research, you know, idea that they want to form a company around. So that's happening this summer too. I just mentioned that June. And I'm looking at applications now for you know, just as long as you have two people, an idea, it is a way to understand how that idea will likely change, even within 4 weeks when you go out and interview people that who know a lot more about this, that idea of where you want to plant it than you do. So this catch and release, that's Terry's terminology from it. So sometimes we do wind up with projects that are released to different people along the way. One of the key components of the biodesign, I mean, and also design thinking process is this idea of rapid iteration. And we do a lot of that, and the students should be doing this, and even in terms of physical prototypes. Different projects will get to different levels of this, but that's a key ingredient. This is the same point. And we do have facilities on the main campus for you know, sort of maker spaces and 3D printing, all sorts of fun stuff like that. Different students use it to different levels. It's one of these things where, you know, wouldn't it be great if you had this space? Well, if I had that space, I couldn't guarantee that there would be someone in it every day.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's hard to justify that way. And there are resources at USC already. It's interesting. Probably the premier one is the Iovine and Young Academy, where they have all sorts of neat toys, but they definitely sort of rope that off. So really, like, people are looking in, ooh, yeah, that looks nice. But there are other, you know, within specific labs, like, you know, Scott Fraser was here and he has different tools available. And ideally what should happen is that students can bring a project to their lab. We have a space in the basement of the Denny Research Building, which is the medical devices lab. It used to be Dr. Jerry Loeb's lab area, and he's very open to sort of providing all sorts of stuff out of his cupboards, and we just replenish it, you know, if they're used by our students. So an example of that, one student we had a few years ago, he came in and he built a prototype of a door entry monitor, so that if you walked in and you didn't use the hand sanitizer, it would beep, right? You know, just a simple idea like that, right? And he won $10,000 for the student innovation competition. We usually have one team that wins at one of the big prizes. Last year, they won. Team worked on an idea of a carbon dioxide monitor for infants, and you probably, if you saw it, it was in the tech news a couple times, but instead of having to move it from one point to another on the baby, because it heats up a spot in the way it monitors temperature, I mean carbon dioxide level, you have to, they had a sort of a multi-pronged, and it would just automatically alternate the contact point. And so they won $10,000 for that. They moved on, and they didn't win the big grand prize. I'll tell you about that prize as well. But you know, it is one project that started as a class project. You know, sending people to the NICU looking for needs. They came up with that one. Part of what, in terms of training and empathy, is really helping the students reflect on their information gathering experience. And that's, you know, and I talk about it in this point, you know, in terms of lots of channels of feedback, not just verbal, but also observational, and any kind of sort of things going on around the need as well. So these are more tools from the design thinking approach. Look at extreme users, the unfocused group as opposed to a focus group. You know, get people who are at the extremes, straight from the sort of the playlist of design thinking. That's where that comes from. Again, just lots of. So this is what I'm doing with the students in the first half of the first year, mainly making sure they exercise these different, use these different tools essentially, and definitely sort of invite your harshest critics to give their best shot, because you have to be able to sort of reply and respond to that. So this is probably one of the most sort of one of the biggest wins. These guys in the middle. Gene, Brian, and Dan, two engineers, one medical student. They won $50,000 a couple of years ago. And this was an eye tracking device that could tell you about the after effect of head trauma. So they were able to pilot this in the Pasadena school system, because they were actually implementing something for their athletes.
Yeah.
At the same, so the timing was nice too, right? Mm-hmm. So they can add this as a new dimension, because the tragic thing about this is, with paper and pencil testing for this kind of stuff, people fake bad at the beginning, and then they get bonked, and then they do their best so that the difference between pre and post is minimized, right? You can't lie with an eye tracking device, right? It'll, and so it sort of takes that away, but it's so sad, because then they go on, and if they did have a significant head trauma, on top of that, a second one just sort of shoots their risk for long-term damage through the roof. I learned that lesson the hard way when I played hockey,
right.
And I quit two times in my career.
It's from being Canadian. These guys don't know that.
We'd actually worked with Reebok on a hockey helmet that ended up getting funded by a company out in Boston called MC10,
mm-hmm.
and that had the green, yellow, red, marker for repetitive head trauma in hockey players.
So where'd you hide the reset button?
That's exactly right. Somewhere they can't find it.
Right. It has to be reset by the coach. But the coaches probably would conspire with them, that's my best player. I want them back on the ice, right? Yeah.
Other things, great.
Yeah. I mean, it. Actually, the need that I'm thinking of right now is came up when I was, and this is what I try to teach my students, they should be always constantly listening. And so my latest need, and we've had students work on posture, right? So one student group you know, so you're like this, and it would just sort of tug you. So they had a sensor and a mechanical thing that would actually tug you, which is really important for busy cities.
You realize that there are a couple of companies now that have actually back little accelerometers from the back. You put the form factor is not great, but you put it on the back. It's almost like it's a necklace you can put on, and it sits on the back. I can't remember what it's named, like a
Lumo.
Or
Lumo
back. Lumo back. That's it. Yeah, Lumo, and then it bugs you when you're not.
Yeah, it used to send it to your phone, right? It would say, you know, tsk, 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 your grandma would scold you now, you know, something like that, right? Now it's kind of, it used to be at the small of your back, that company. And one of the things that,
neurostimulator. But for those things, it's really, it becomes, it's not just the, you know, it's not just the accelerometer or the gyroscope or the sensor, it's really, how do you bug people into doing what you think they should be doing or what they think they should be doing? It's really complicated.
The metaphor is not used very often these days, but when I was growing up, you always saw TV shows with people, you know, drowning in quicksand.
Yeah.
You know, so, and that's the quicksand issue, right?
Right.
The behavioral change piece, right? And, you know, there's a lot that's better understood. I mean, I encourage, in terms of that last slide about, you know, looking for extremes, right? So, you know, look at gambling, right? Look at, you know, like how do, you know, these are the experts at behavioral change and locking people into new behavior patterns, right?
Really, yeah.
And, you know, like how, and we actually, at USC, there is one company called, it's either called dopamine or I think it's called dopamine. It's basically, you know, looking at and they provide sort of back-end software for intermittent reinforcement as you look at a website, and it'll sort of capture your attention and then sort of reward you in some ways in a schedule that's not predictable, so that you will be more likely to be hooked by that website.
Gambling.
Taking lessons from gambling and apply them to web interfaces. But you could apply that to, you know, diabetic behavior change, you know, tracking and modeling.
There you are.
It's very interesting that different companies now in the digital health space have kind of incorporated more of that. And that's why I've actually, when I said we're getting more master's students, I created a master's program joint between Keck and Viterbi for computer science. People who want to come in, understand more healthcare, and get themselves on a team that actually delivers something in healthcare. The other thing, if this is an area of interest too, we have faculty that teach strategy and design for websites at USC, right? One of the things I can do, and what I do with the students, and I, just as clinicians would use students as the secret sauce that run around and connect things and people, I'll get them to sort of explore different courses and what other faculty members are doing.
It's
interesting because the pure computer there's two pieces at USC. There's the Game Pipe Lab.
There's always these competing, there's computer science, and then there's sometimes computer
cinematography,
and sometimes they have different silos.
Yeah, it's unfortunate, but that's true. I mean, but
there's not like a core, like where they come together, necessarily.
Where they come together are the students, right? Like if you can have a student who can go to take a cinematography course, and that's on sort of more of the visual game design piece, and then they could be doing the programming with the Game Pipe Lab and Mike Zaida's team, and do more of like, and you know, be sort of next door neighbors to people who are just doing game programming, which is, and they get every year their program is rated number one. So we've had one student in our program from a PhD in computer science who was in both camps, actually. His primary advisor was Mike Zaida, and he also worked a lot with Mary and Tina Gotsis. And so he's good. They won third prize in this competition, right? And they like that because the medical student, it's a good thing too, because it takes so much time to get dressed up like that. And I don't have time for that. It's $50,000. You guys only got $10,000, right? Yeah, well. So this year we had members of the program were on the second and third team, but there wasn't a full team per se that won it this year. We've done workshops. We created an outfit called D-Health, Digital Health, in terms of apps. What I do now is I teach a fourth year elective, so it's a rapid immersion in app design. That's how usually around 8 to 10 fourth year medical students take it. Some of them, one of them had it this year for the first time, got an app onto the app store, like after 4 weeks.
Yeah,
that's pretty impressive. Sure. But most of the time it's really a lesson. You think this is easy, right? You know, go out and talk to some people you think would love your app, and you might learn different. Right, so that's kind of what that's about. And then, you know, this is Hugh Gordon, the guy who just graduated. He was part of this when they graduated from they went after they did their HDE project here at Keck Hospital. They took their learnings about, you know, HIPAA and data security and, you know, getting different data sets to interconnected to for a specific purpose, and they went through Y Combinator, and they graduated at the top of their class, and so they got over $4 million of funding. And they have their company is called Akito Labs. They're downtown. I visited them. It's kind of neat to see. It's a proud moment when you go and see that, you know, your students who have started a company, and now they have like 12 or 13 people working there, and they're even thinking about the future that, you know, they're subletting half of their space, you know, in this place downtown. And this is an older slide, so this only goes to May 2015. So this is why it's taken him a little bit longer to graduate.
Brad Selby's on the board of this, isn't he as well?
This one?
No,
probably not.
I meant D-Health.
D-Health? Well, he could be, yeah. That would make sense. I don't know. So D-Health actually mentors now other startup companies,
right,
that have some kind of link to USC.
Got it.
So we're on board members together,
right,
for one of those companies.
Right, blockchain.
So that's advisors.
Yes.
that's my first advisory role. This is more of a sort of an academic slide on, you know, what I like to distinguish between interdisciplinary to transdisciplinary teams, and we don't need to get into this. It's mainly the metaphor I like to use is when you come to a meeting and you're there to solve a problem, you can decide to use your own language and have that other person learn your language to solve the problem the way you frame things and solve problems, and they could do the same with you, or you can say this problem, you know, we need to figure out a new language. And I think when you get to a point of figuring out a new language together, a new way to talk, a new dialogue, that's what I call transdisciplinary. Great examples of this are, like, you know, sort of, you know, the historical example is building an atom bomb. Like, if you want to build, you know, they have to have experimental physicists talk to theoretical physicists. And before that sort of urgent need, they didn't really sort of, you know, talk the same language. And arguably that's one case. Yeah, so this was just a talk on this topic. So this is kind of what the program's about, just from an academic standpoint. These are not sort of math CME questions on the right hand side. Those are like first semester it's 2 units, second semester it's 2 units, and just sort of how the sequence works. So in the first year, it's really it's light on the academic side by design, because medical students pay for 16 credits. Their medical school uses up 16 credits. When you pay full tuition, you get 18. 16 plus 2 equals 18, so they don't have to pay anything extra. But they learn a lot extra. And one of the things I tell students when they're thinking of applying is that a lot of people decide to become doctors, they feel it's a calling, but a lot of people also get bored after a while. Unless you really have something that you really love to do, that you can weave it into being a doctor as well, you might get bored. And this is one way to potentially protect yourself from that kind of burnout. So it doesn't add too much coursework for the medical students. For the engineering students, it adds more because they're actually taking some courses with the medical students that they otherwise would not take. But like the full year of introduction to clinical medicine is part of that. So that's kind of this isn't really for this talk, but what it helps you see, they're I encourage them beyond the academic side to enter into these competitions. They can also participate in activities around USC too. So there's the Pasadena Angels, there's the Tech Coast Angels. Some students, after they graduate and they have a company, have gone to the incubator at Cedars-Sinai. Stasis Labs is another successful company with some students who came out. You met Michael, mm-hmm. co-founder. So my claim on them is that his co-founder was a student in the program for a year, but he actually was back from India this mm-hmm. past week. But there are certain students you can spot right away who are really have it and who are able to keep their primary advisors happy, which is a skill in and of itself, because the PhD students are all working on their PhD thesis at the same time. So if they go wander off and do something with HTE, it can become too much of a distraction from the point of view of the primary advisor. But those who are able to manage their expectations of their primary advisor take on so much. I started working with engineers in the healthcare context when I was running a research department in Toronto, and I would bring in undergraduate engineers. This is part of the reason why I jumped at the chance to do this something similar here. And the physicians, I'd get them involved in, it was a cardiovascular surgeon there, Doug Wooster, and he knows Dr. Weaver here. Dr. Wooster said, you should think about bringing in some Waterloo students. And I said, that's a great idea. So we had this long chain of amazing students who came through. And the engineering students, undergraduate in particular, I just gave them lots of different projects, and they were always hungry for more. And the doctors on the other side were like, can you get more of these? It's a little one person. And it worked out really well, because some of those students wound up becoming physicians themselves. Others went biomedical engineering. One of them, what I love is one of them really got into biomedical engineering, became a biomedical engineer, went to graduate school, wound up at Mass General, worked with Joan Brown, mm-hmm. And said, do you happen to know Karen Tan? It's like, Karen. It was really quite very rewarding to that sort of connection that you see over time. And I'm seeing more of, I was speaking about the digital health or Akito lab guys and their place downtown. And so that's potentially, you know, you guys can see some of that as well. One advantage of working with undergraduate students, if you don't use too many resources, you don't use significant resources of USC, the IP is with you and the students,
mm-hmm.
potentially. So that policy may be revisited, but for now that's how it's written up.
Mm-hmm.
These guys have their own IP, and so did Aikido Labs as well. So, and again, that's part of both that they come up with the project and that they own the IP or co-owners sometimes. That motivates them to keep going too. Sometimes I'm asked, you know, so how do you pick the projects for the students? And it's like, well, I don't do that. Like, if you know, I have to pick it for them, they didn't really sort of get the message, right? So, but I'd love it to, you know, open more channels for, you know, bringing in some of the secret sauce or not so secret anymore,
yeah.
Of students to work with you guys too.
Well, I think you kind of had us at hello. This is like what it's all about. I mean, the biggest problem I think for practicing clinician is exactly this: is that they're isolated, that they're siloed. The biggest problem with practicing engineer is that he or she is siloed and isolated, and they're going to identify, yesterday's problems tomorrow. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
what you're doing is you're adding energy into the system, like we've talked about, right?
Yeah.
To fight that entropy. And you're doing it in a novel way, is focusing on the students, which, as you say, sometimes glue the particles. Like, you understand that kind of make that thing roll? But the hardest part, really, is place, is having the engineers bump into the physician, the surgeon, the physician, surgeon, scientist. And that's what, you know, we've dealt with this for years and years, and I've fought this system for the last 20 years in getting primary appointments in surgery for engineers.
Yeah.
And that used to be exotic. It still kind of is, but it's really cool when you can do it. And you're doing it by way of students.
Yeah. I think what you're saying is, you know, it made me think about how just different environments that the students can feel like this is okay for me to be doing that. And one of the sort of zones that I have is just the camaraderie within my group,
yeah.
right? So even if they're feeling like, oh boy, it's taking a long time to meet with Dr. So-and-so, or, you know, like, they can talk about it with their group as well, and sort of like, well, I found that this and this can help facilitate that.
Right.
One of the things that I'm, you know, probably would be good to talk about, and why I like the idea of different certificate programs that come from different departments, because it creates another stratum where the people could probably act as an interface between students and clinicians. Like, Karen probably could be doing some of that with, you know, with you and with students.
For sure.
So that they have someone that they can reach on the phone a little bit more consistently, right?
Right.
So with radiology, there's someone that is a point of contact, and he's readily available. So then I have someone to work with, and they can sort of say, okay, if you want to reach Dr. So-and-so, this is the way to do it. You know, that kind of practical kind of in-between interface.
I mean, that's what it takes. It takes energy and consistency.
Mm-hmm.
But speaking of which, we want to thank you for your energy
you so
and vision. I look forward to a long-term collaboration.
Thank you.